New York State's highest court has come down unanimously in favor of discrimination, but only what it calls reverse discrimination. What the court said is that it's perfectly proper in some situations to give minority groups favoritism when it comes to school admissions or job hiring. The United States Supreme Court so far has managed to dodge that issue, but the court has not been able to get away from criticism that in the past few years it's been turning against individual rights. And in a speech yesterday to a meeting of judges and lawyers in Minnesota, Chief Justice Warren Berger said that the court's record recently on this issue is at least as good as it ever was before. One individual rights issue facing the court right now is whether or not the death penalty is constitutional. And for some people, it's literally a life or death question.
The Louisiana State Penitentiary, death row, where 35 men spend their lives awaiting a decision from the U.S. Supreme Court that might send them to the electric chair. Gary Tyler is one of them. At 17, he is one of the youngest inmates condemned to die in the United States. Tyler has been on death row since last December, convicted when he was 16 of shooting to death a 13-year-old white boy in Destrehan, Louisiana, during a time of racial unrest. Prosecutors said Tyler fired the gun from a school bus he was riding. But now, a key witness against Tyler says she lied at his trial. In a sworn statement, Natalie Blanks, a black schoolmate of Tyler, changed her story. At the trial, she testified she saw Tyler's hand protruding from the school bus window, holding a pistol, after the shot was fired. But now, she says, prosecutors threatened to charge her with accessory to murder and perjury unless she implicated Tyler, a charge the prosecutors deny. As for Tyler, he says he is innocent.
I had witnessed he must testify that I didn't commit this crime. I didn't.
So why is Gary Tyler sitting here on death row?
Why is he sitting here? Well, he's been framed, and they wanted someone. They figured since he was available, they're going to take and grab him.
Tyler's new attorney, Jack Peebles, is seeking another trial based on Natalie Blank's recantation. Tulane University law students in New Orleans who have taken an interest in the case meet with Peebles every Sunday to map out their strategy. And a Gary Tyler defense fund has been set up, but contributions are said to be coming in very slowly. Still, Tyler has the support of some Louisiana blacks who think he has been railroaded because he is black.
And I am sick and tired of white racist America killing off our black men.
The motion for a new trial will be heard April 21st, and although prosecutors would not discuss details of the case, they think Tyler already has had his day in court. And as far as they're concerned, the Gary Tyler case is closed. Bernard Goldberg, CBS News, Angola,
Louisiana.
A man who
was wrongly convicted of first-degree murder spent 41 years in a Louisiana prison until his murder conviction was overturned in 2016. That man will speak about his experiences tonight at Viterbo University, and he joins us this morning. We have Gary Tyler here with us. Good morning, Gary.
Good morning. How you doing?
Well, I'm doing great, and it's great to have you here this morning. So for folks who aren't familiar, why don't you tell us a little bit about your story?
Well, my name is Gary, and over four decades ago, there was an incident that happened October 7th, 1974, where during the racial integration, there was a riot at a school. And throughout the process, I was accused of killing a 13-year-old white student at Destrehan High School, you know. And you know, during that time, it was a time of, forced busing. And many people, they still wasn't accustomed to being told what to do at that time. But I felt strongly that the intentions were great when it came down to the education of the kids themselves. And it was the way of trying to improve things back then. But unfortunately, it's somewhere down the line, things just got out of hand, and it just really riled those up in the community who really opposed it at the time.
And you've maintained your innocence all this time.
Yes.
You've been able to bring your story to different groups and organizations all around the country, including right here. You've been to Viterbo University twice now already.
Yes.
So this is the third time that you're here. What are you hoping that folks will take away from your speech tonight?
Well, like always, I feel one of the most important things is to be able to share my story. And it's not so much the man himself and what I went through, it's that what people go through and how they're able to overcome odds and challenges. And that's one thing that I feel that's important. Despite, you know, what an individual go through, despite an individual having to be unjustly, you know, accused and convicted and sentenced, you understand, first, you know, given a death penalty and later given life in prison. But, you know, due to the support, of course, of the family and others, that tends to help you to shoulder that burden and, you know, and eventually persevere despite the odds that are, you know, that you're dealing with. And I just want people to know that despite challenges, people tend to overcome, especially when it's about the right thing.
Well, we'll certainly be looking forward to your speech tonight over at Viterbo University. Gary, thank you for taking just a couple of minutes to join us this morning and talk a little bit about it.
You know, thank you for inviting me. I appreciate it a lot.
All right, and now we'll send it over to Kyle.
Each time a man stands up for an ideal or acts to improve the lot of others or strikes out against injustice, he sends forth a tiny ripple of hope. Those ripples build a current which can sweep down the mightiest walls of oppression and resistance.
Who carries on RFK's message, legacy, and voice? I believe the answer is my neighbor, Gary Tyler.
I had the fortune of going to prison. Not serving time initially, but being sentenced to die in the electric chair for murder that I was falsely accused of. Just imagine a 16-year-old kid back then in 1974, being tried for his life and convicted, given the death penalty, and assigned an execution date.
Oh, yes, it will. It's been too hard living, but I'm afraid to
die. We should continue to push, because we're talking about the lives of people, you know, so. Yes, I'm a prop 62.
Both Gary Tyler and Robert F. Kennedy have attempted to remove the death penalty from the justice system, deeming it unconstitutional. In this past election year, Gary Tyler worked to advocate for Prop 62. Sadly, the proposition did not get passed, and the death penalty is still a punishment in California. Both men, defenders of human rights, chose the power of compassion, not the power of destruction.
You can be filled with bitterness and with hatred and a desire for revenge. We can move in that direction as a country in greater polarization, filled with hatred toward one another. Or we can make an effort, as Martin Luther King did, to understand and to comprehend and replace that violence, that stain of bloodshed that is spread across our land, with an effort to understand passion and love.
In order to change the culture of violence in Angola, we had to replace it with something constructive, something that would get the guys' attention to where they want to better themselves.
Gary Tyler was an organizer for the ASCP, the Angola Special Civic Project. He was also an original recruiter and hospice volunteer. He was a volunteer at the Angola Hospice Program for 17 years. Gary was the president of the Angola Prison Drama Club and directed a famous play called The Life of Jesus Christ.
What we need in the United States is not division. What we need in the United States is not hatred. What we need in the United States is not violence and lawlessness, but is love and wisdom and compassion toward one another.
Start to understand each other And when that changed, then violence started subsiding.
In this difficult day, in this difficult time for the United States, it's perhaps well to ask what kind of a nation we are and what direction we want to move in.
So I feel that whatever anyone, man or woman, go through, that they reach a point in life where they recognize that what they go through has an impact on other people and people that come, understand, after them. These organizations that they can really become a part of, that they give them purpose and meaning, you know, purpose and meaning in life.
In the face of sadness and injustice, both men set in motion ripples of hope that still reverberate in our neighborhoods, our institutions, and our communities.
By listening to the young men that come into Angola, when they told me that if there were men like me in a community when they was growing up, that most likely they wouldn't be in prison. The life I lived, the life that others lived, what they went through, that it exemplifies how an individual can overcome these adversities and these challenges and how they can make a difference in their community.
I am inspired by my neighbor, Gary Tyler, who carries on Robert F. Kennedy's legacy and message. Who inspires you? A long time coming, but I know.